Es realmente un honor y un agrado para nosotros tener hoy día como invitada a la profesora Helen Fisher. Ella es antropóloga biológica, es investigadora asociada al Centro de Estudios Evolucionarios Humanos en la Universidad, en el Departamento de Antropología de la Universidad de Rutgers. Ha escrito numerosos artículos académicos en revistas especializadas sobre diversos temas que son del interés de todos nosotros: la evolución de la sexualidad humana, el amor romántico, el matrimonio, el divorcio. También sobre diferencias cerebrales entre hombres y mujeres, en su comportamiento y en la elección de parejas. Ha sido además pionera en el análisis de resonancias magnéticas para estudiar el circuito cerebral del amor romántico. Ella es autora de varios libros, 5 libros, está preparando otros 2. Todos estos libros han sido traducidos a varios idiomas, entre ellos el español. Y quiero agradecer la presencia de Helen Fisher en el CEP. Creo que es una oportunidad tremendamente interesante para todos nosotros de aprender más sobre estos temas. Su conferencia, como ustedes ven, ya está puesta, o estaba puesta. Y el título yo creo que no necesita mayor traducción. Así que sin más quiero darle la bienvenida, agradecerle su presencia. Quiero también, antes de partir, agradecerle a la Fundación Ciencia y Evolución. Sin el apoyo de ella y de Álvaro Fischer, Helen Fischer, no son parientes, no estaría hoy día aquí. Muchas gracias. I think so.
Oh, hello.
Oh.
todavía por aquí disponibles. Creo que al lado de allá, no sé si quedan algunos espacios. Y si no, tendremos que estar apretaditos nomás. No sé, algunos a lo mejor se pueden sentar aquí adelante, en el piso, digamos, si no les incomoda. Las opciones son múltiples. Algunos se pueden sentar en las piernas de otro, digamos, si es que, no de otra, digamos, dependiendo de circunstancias. No, no, no tiene por qué ser ninguna de las tres cosas, digamos.
I'm delighted to be here. I'm delighted that you are here. How many people will be listening to me in English, if you could just raise your hand? Okay, thanks. I just need to know how fast to talk. Pablo Neruda once wrote, "I love you without knowing how, or when, or from where." These are the questions that I've sought to answer with my career. I and my colleagues have now put over 50 people who were madly in love into a brain scanner to study the brain circuitry of romantic love and also now attachment. 17 of these people had just fallen madly in love. They were happily in love. 15 of them had just been rejected in love. And the last 17 in our most recent experiment were people who were in their 50s and married, happily married, and reported that they were still in love, not just loving, but in love with their partner after an average of 21 years of marriage. So this is the story of that research. Along the way, I want to give you a theory for the evolution of the human family. We are a remarkable species in that we bother to pair up and rear our children as a team. 97% of mammals do not pair up to rear their young. Human beings do. As a matter of fact, I'm always asked by the press why we are so adulterous. The real story is that we bother to pair up at all, and indeed we do. So I want to talk about why we marry, why we divorce, and last but not least, why you fall in love with one person rather than another. This is that story. Darwin was annoyed at what he saw in nature when he was a young man. all of the colored stripes and tufts of hair and pendulous noses that he found in nature, all of these appendages he found cumbersome and metabolically expensive, and they attracted parasites. But most important, they undermined his theory that everything evolved for a purpose. In fact, he was particularly angry at the peacock's tail. He once wrote to his son, "The sight of the feathers in a peacock's tail, every time I look at them, make me sick." This puzzle finally galvanized him to propose his theory of sexual selection. Some things evolved not just to survive another day, but to play the mating game. Some characteristics evolved so that individuals could fight with those of their same gender. And some characteristics evolved because the opposite sex thought they were beautiful. This is the bald wakari, South American monkey. Females think that red face is absolutely glorious. They like it, they don't know it, but they like it because it's built by testosterone. We like the same kinds of things. The strong human jaw, male jaw, and heavy brow ridge in men is built also by testosterone, and women find it extremely attractive. Men tend to like the very round face, the puffy lips, the large eyes, and the very soft face, because it's built by estrogen. Since Darwin started talking about natural selection, hundreds, if not thousands, of academic papers have come out talking about all those characteristics that humans and other animals have evolved in order to attract a mate. But nobody's ever asked the question, what happens in the mind of the viewer? What is it in the brain of the person looking at that trait that fires up the mind and makes you attracted to him or her? And so I embarked on trying to understand the brain, the part of the brain that gets triggered when we fall in love and are attracted to another human being. So now I will really start by saying that around the world, people love. They sing for love, they dance for love, they compose poems and stories and ballets and operas and movies and plays about love. We tell myths and legends about love. We have love charms, love potions, love magic. People pine for love, they live for love, they kill for love, and they die for love. It's one of the most powerful brain systems on earth. I'm going to maintain that it's much more powerful than the sex drive. You know, if you casually ask somebody to go to bed with you and they say no thank you, you don't kill yourself. Around the world, people kill themselves, they kill other people, they slip into clinical depression over romantic love. So I began to study it. A friend of mine has now looked in 170 societies. He found activity, found evidence of romantic love in every single one of them. There were no exceptions. I then did my own questionnaire study among Americans and Japanese, and I found that there were really some basic qualities to romantic love. First of all, I found no gender differences. Americans, and probably Chileans also, believe that men are not as romantic as women are. It's just simply not true. Men fall in love faster than women do. Men have more intimate conversations with their wives than women do with their husbands, because women have their intimate conversations with other women. Men are 2.5 times more likely to kill themselves when a relationship is over, and men are more likely to remarry than women are. And when we looked in the brain, those parts of the brain associated with that intense feeling of romantic love was no different in men than they were in women. I also found that it can occur at any age. My people who were over age 45 showed just as much romantic love as did those who were under age 25. As a matter of fact, I was recently making a speech in New York City. It happened to be to mothers. And in the middle of the speech, I asked them, does anybody in the room have a child who's in love? And one woman said, yes, her son was in love. Every single time a particular little girl came over to their house, he would just sit next to her and stroke her hair. And then when she left, he would be depressed for about an hour and a half. So I asked the woman how old her son was, and she said, he's 2 and a half. Romantic love is a brain system like the fear system. You can be scared at any age, and you can be in love at any age. I also found that my homosexuals in my study showed just as much expression of romantic love as did my heterosexuals. I'm not talking about who you love, I'm talking about how the brain behaves when you feel love. And it's my guess that the gay brain, in that respect, is exactly like the straight brain. So I began to think that romantic love is really one of three basic brain systems that evolved from mating and reproduction.
One is the sex drive,
associated with testosterone in both men and women. Pablo Neruda called it an infinite thirst or eternal ache. It can be associated with anybody. You can feel the sex drive when you, for a whole range of partners. It can have no object whatsoever and is associated with testosterone in both men and women. The second brain system, romantic love, also known as passionate love, obsessive love, being in love, or infatuation. I'm going to maintain it's associated with different chemical systems in the brain. It's focused on only one person. George Bernard Shaw called love, he once said, love consists of overestimating the differences between one woman and another. And indeed, we do. And the third brain system is attachment. Other scientists have studied the brain chemicals and brain circuitry of this system associated with oxytocin and vasopressin. I think that all three brain systems evolved. I think the sex drive evolved to get you out there looking for a whole range of partners. I think romantic love evolved to enable you to focus your mating energy on just one person at a time. And I think that attachment, that third brain system, evolved to enable you to tolerate this human being at least long enough to raise a child together as a team. They interact. When you fall madly in love with somebody, suddenly everything about them becomes sexually attractive. The way they walk, the way they touch their hair, the way they fiddle with their pencil, everything about them becomes sexually attractive. And it is probably because as you fall in love, you're driving up dopamine, and dopamine triggers the testosterone system and thus triggers the sex drive. But can the reverse be true? Can you have casual sex with somebody and then fall in love with them? Well, most liberated adults have had casual sex with somebody and not fallen in love with them. So it certainly doesn't always happen. But it can happen. And the reason it can happen is that because any kind of sexual stimulation drives up dopamine in the brain and can push you over the threshold into falling in love. Right after orgasm, there's a real spike of norepinephrine, which can also sustain feelings of romantic love. And then, of course, with orgasm, there's a real flood of oxytocin and vasopressin, which can give you feelings of deep attachment to this individual. So, casual sex is almost never casual, unless you're so drunk that you can't remember it, something happens in the brain. As a matter of fact, there was a recent study of kissing, and over 50% of both men and women said that they had started to fall for somebody, but the first kiss was the kiss of death. They never wanted to kiss the person again. So something happens when you go to bed with somebody. And in fact, I'm in the middle of a study, actually, with a graduate student at a university on the Northeast in America. And we wanted to know why it is that all these teenagers go and have their one-night stands, just casual sex with somebody. So we asked 500 students why they went to bed with somebody they hardly knew. And 50% of women and 52% of men said that they did it hoping to trigger a longer relationship with this person. And one-third succeeded in doing it. So there's two ways to get the boy or the girl. Either you spend months talking to them, or you get into bed with them as soon as you can and trigger these brain systems for a romantic love. And probably during the course of human evolution, more people took the first avenue. The problem with these relationships is that a great many people in America and around the world are now taking serotonin boosters, Prozac, Paxil, Zoloft, which drives up serotonin in the brain. And as you drive up serotonin, you are suppressing the dopamine system. And I have been maintaining for some time that when you take these serotonin boosters and you're suppressing the dopamine system, you're going to have a harder time falling in love or staying in love. I'm not suggesting that people who are seriously ill and need these brain chemicals not take them. But in America, a Harvard psychiatrist recently said that something like 73% of Americans taking serotonin boosters don't need them. And indeed, they're jeopardizing their ability to sustain these dopamine levels and feel romantic attraction. And of course, if they don't go to bed with the person and these drugs kill the sex drive, they're not going to have the flood of oxytocin or vasopressin too. So these brain systems are often connected, but not always connected. You can lie in bed and feel deep attachment to one person and then swing to wild feelings of intense romantic love for somebody else, and then swing to feelings of the sex drive for even a third person. It's as if there's a committee meeting going on in your head as you are swinging from one brain system to another. As a result, of course, I think the brain is very well built to fall in love and form a pair bond and start a family together. It's also very well built for adultery, divorce, and remarriage. We have this enormous cerebral cortex with which each one of us makes our decisions on how we are going to lead our lives. But the brain itself is extremely versatile and able to do more than one reproductive strategy. So the brain system that I was interested in most recently is the brain system for romantic love. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through the basic characteristics of romantic love, then tell you what we found in the brain, tell you about rejection in the brain, the evolution of romantic love, and then on to my most recent research on why you fall in love with one person rather than another. The first thing that happens when you fall in love is the person takes on what I call special meaning. As one man said to me, he said, "The world had a new center, and that center was Marianne." And indeed, everything about this person becomes special. The car they drive is different from every other car in the parking lot. The house they live in, the street they live on, the music that they like, everything about them becomes special. And then they focus on this person. That's dopamine that's associated with that focus. You can list what you don't like about your sweetheart. And in fact, before I put the people in the machine, I would ask them, "What do you not like about him or her?" And they would tell me. But then they swept that aside and just focused on what they did like.
intense energy.
When things are going well, you can walk all night and talk till dawn.
Euphoria. When things are going well, mood swings into horrible despair. When things are going poorly, bodily reactions, that's probably norepinephrine.
Awkwardness, stammering, butterflies in your stomach. Stendhal once said, he said, every time I would take her arm, I felt as if I had forgotten how to walk. Isn't that a shame? That moment that you want to be the most charming and you can barely stage a civilized hello. Real emotional dependency on this person. You're feeling perfectly fine and then you go to your computer and you look and there's no email and you plunge into despair. As a matter of fact, before I put these people into the machine, I would ask them all kinds of questions. And I'm not a psychologist, I'm an anthropologist. And the question I had to really work myself up to was, I would say at some point, would you die for him or her? And they would say yes. They would say yes as if I had asked them to pass the salt. They were just remarkable. Frustration attraction is a term that I made up. When there's a barrier to the relationship, you just try harder. You just love the person more. I think I now understand some of the brain circuitry of that, which we can talk about later. Possessiveness, if you're casually sleeping with somebody, you don't care if they're sleeping with somebody else. But when you're in love, it's called mate guarding in the animal community. But the three basic characteristics of romantic love are intense craving for emotional union. Sure, you'd like to go to bed with them, but what you really want is emotional union with them. You're highly motivated to win them. What people will do when they are in love is absolutely astonishing. And most important, you obsessively think about them. Before I put people in the machine, the most important question that I would ask them was, what percentage of the day and night do you think about him or her? And they would say all the time. I never stop thinking about him. I wake up thinking about her. I go to bed thinking about him. I never stop thinking about them. Those are the people that I would put in the machine. I wanted them really crazy. These machines are expensive. And it's very time consuming. And last but not least, it's involuntary. Stendhal once said, love is like a fever. It comes and goes quite independently of the will. And it does. So having assembled these group of traits from reading the last 40 years of psychological literature, I also read a great deal of world poetry. I think poetry is a wonderful artifact of the human mind. Other anthropologists use potsherds to understand behavior or arrowheads. I use world poetry. And the world poetry, the poems from the Aztecs poetry, peoples probably on Easter Island, certainly ancient Japan, ancient Egypt, the poetry all says the same thing. It all, in one way or another, talks about these traits. So having looked at these traits, I began to think, what would I find in the brain? Everything in red is a characteristic that is likely to be associated with the neurotransmitter dopamine. Bodily reactions is probably associated with the neurotransmitter norepinephrine. Mate guarding is probably associated with the vasopressin system. And obsessive thinking is probably associated with low levels of serotonin. So I hypothesized that if I looked in the brain, I may find activity in any one or all of these brain systems. So I assembled a team, and my hypothesis was that I would find activity, elevated activity in the dopamine and norepinephrine system, and low activity in the serotonin system. So then I assembled a team, Art Aaron, social psychologist Lucy Brown, Albert Einstein College of Medicine, our neuroscientist, myself, and some graduate students. And we started to put people in the brain scanner. You can't get two people in a brain scanner. But this is the New Yorker's magazine's vision of what we were doing. Because I'm with an academic audience, I'll tell you very briefly what the protocol was. I had them look at a photograph of their sweetheart for 30 seconds, and I had them look at a photograph of somebody who was a totally neutral individual who called forth no positive or negative feelings in their brain for 30 seconds. And so my control was the same brain looking at a neutral individual as opposed to the one that fired up the brain. The problem with that is that when you're madly in love with somebody, you can't stop thinking about them. So I needed a distraction task. So between looking at the positive photograph and the neutral photograph, I would cast a large number on the screen, like 4,821. And they would have to look at that number and then in their mind count backwards in increments of 7. Drives all the blood to a tiny little part of the parietal lobe. You don't feel anything except a little anxiety as you're counting. And that way, I put all the scans of the positive and the neutral on top of each other and canceled out what they had in common, leaving the brain in love. We found a lot of things. Particularly, we found activity in a little factory near the base of the brain, the ventral tegmental area, in some cells called the A10 cells that actually make dopamine and send dopamine to many brain regions. We also found a lot of activity in the caudate nucleus, which receives something like 80% of the dopamine in the brain. They're both basic parts of the brain system for wanting. They're part of the reward system, the brain system for wanting, for craving, for obsession, for motivation, for focus, for ecstasy. And when I discovered this, I finally realized what romantic love really was. I had thought that romantic love was an emotion, or a group of emotions, from high to low. And of course, a lot of emotions are involved. But what it really is a drive, a basic human drive, a need, an urge, a homeostatic imbalance, a human drive to seek life's greatest prize, a mating partner. In fact, I think of all the poetry that has ever talked about romantic love, and they all talk about it, the best is done by Plato, who once said, "The god of love lives in a state of need. It is a need. It is a craving. It is an obsession to find somebody to send your DNA with into tomorrow." So, having done that, here's my part of the caudate nucleus. There's a lot of characteristics of a drive that romantic love has. The one that I find particularly interesting is that there's no facial expression. You know, you can look at somebody and know whether they're angry or sad or happy. You can't look at somebody and know whether they're hungry or thirsty. And in the same way, you can't look at somebody and know whether they're in love. All of the drives, in one way or another, are associated with the dopamine system. So having done that, I had always maintained that romantic love must be an addiction. It's got all the characteristics of an addiction. A perfectly wonderful addiction when it's going well, and a perfectly horrible addiction when it's going poorly. And having done this experiment, and it went around the world, and everybody was interested in it, and I said, "Wait a minute, who cares what happens in the brain when you're happily in love? What's really important is what happens in the brain when you've been rejected in love. That's when you turn into a pest. That's when you turn into somebody who is homicidal or suicidal or falling into clinical depression. So what I really need to study is the brain, the rejected brain." So I began to look around for people who had just been dumped. And I put this, have you just been rejected in love, but can't let go? You can't let go when you've been rejected in love. What a bad deal. I mean, wouldn't it be nice to just walk away? But we don't. We hang on and on and on. So I began to find people who had just been rejected in love and put them in the machine. My hypothesis was that I would find activity in some of the main pathways for addiction. The article came out a month ago after 10 years of working on it in the Journal of Neurophysiology in the United States, and indeed I found what I was looking for. I found activity in some of the main addiction centers. I found activity in three brain regions, particularly the nucleus accumbens and all along this pathway associated with profound cocaine addiction. Three areas associated with craving, that same brain region associated with intense romantic love, a brain region associated with attachment, and a brain region associated not only with actually physical pain too, but the emotional distress that goes along with physical pain. So basically, when you've been rejected in love, you're madly in love with this person still, you're feeling deeply attached to them, you're in physical and emotional pain, and you profoundly crave them. That is a very powerful brain system. Now, so having done that, I began to think, nature's overdone this. Why is it that we feel this? And so I have, because I am an anthropologist, evolutionary anthropologist, I'd like to trace a little of why I think that this evolved. Darwin thought that all animals fell in love. As he wrote, it was evidently a case of love at first sight, for she swam around the newcomer caressingly with overtures of affection. He was talking about a mallard duck who had fallen in love with a pintail duck, a duck of a different species. Bad mistake. You gotta fall for somebody of your own species. Since then, nobody's talked about romantic love in other animals. I've now looked in over 100 species, and you see evidence in every one of them. A lot of scientists talk about mate choice, and what they basically are saying that there's not an animal on this planet that will have sex with anybody. They have favorites. If they're in the wild, a female elephant will avoid a lot of elephants, and then when she sees the right one, she'll just go straight for him and spend 5 days with just him. And so I began to think there must be some basic attraction system in the animal community that we then evolved into human romantic love. And when you take a look at animal courtship, you see all the main characteristics of romantic love that you see in human beings. Foxes, for example, the beginning of the breeding season, the male will just focus on the female. He'll have intense energy. He loses his appetite the way people do when they're in love. Obsessively follows the female, highly motivated to win her, really guards her, and all kinds of affiliative licking and patting and rubbing up against them. If you saw this on a park bench in downtown Santiago among people, you would say that they are in love. And what there's been two studies of other creatures, prairie vole and a sheep, and when they express this attraction to another, they see an increase in the dopamine activity. I think that's enough of an indication to suggest that this brain system for attraction, what I call animal attraction, at some point during human evolution evolved into what we call human romantic love. So I'm just going to trace that for you. All animals feel attraction, but they don't do it for too long. A rat will feel attraction for about 30 seconds, foxes for about 20 days, elephants for about 5 days. But it doesn't build into a deep attachment. Most mammals do not pair up to rear their young. And I think the evolution of human romantic love and human attachment came together something like 4 million years ago. Our closest relatives do show attraction, but they do not attach. They don't need to. Chimpanzees live in the trees. They're protected. They don't need a mate to protect them. Female carries the baby on her back. She can feed herself. She doesn't need a mate to help her while she's rearing her young. But by 6-7 million years ago, trees began to disappear. Our ancestors were forced down to the ground. on the ground, they began to have to walk on 2 feet and collect things to eat and walk back to a place where they could eat unmolested by predators. They began to pick up weapons to defend themselves. And with the beginning of carrying came walking. And I don't see how a female could carry the equivalent of a 20-pound bowling ball in one arm and sticks and stones in the other arm and protect and feed herself. I think pair bonding became essential for females to survive. I don't see how a male could have protected a harem of females, but he could protect one. So pair bonding became essential to females and suitable to males and the brain circuitry for human attachment and romantic love evolved. I don't know if you know about the most recent fossil find called Ardi, Ardipithecus ramidus, a few months ago, 4.4 million years ago, and we now have some evidence that by 4.4 million years ago, they had already begun to form pair bonds. And along with that, I think, came the evolution of the brain circuitry for romantic love. Something that we see around the world today. But I'm not suggesting that these early pair bonds were necessarily permanent. I've looked at divorce in 58 societies through the demographic yearbooks of the United Nations, and as it turns out, if you're going to divorce, you tend to divorce during and around the 4th year of marriage. And I began to think, wow, that's strange. And then I looked in birds and mammals, and as it turns out, a lot of birds form pair bonds. They have to form pair bonds because somebody's got to sit on those eggs, and that individual will starve to death if somebody doesn't feed them. And so they form a pair bond, but the pair bond lasts only long enough to rear those young through infancy. When the baby flies away, the pair bonds breaks up. And it began to occur to me that 4 years is the period of human, natural period of human infancy. And millions of years ago, I think our ancestors began to pair up and remain together at least long enough to rear their young through infancy. And once a child could join a multi-age play group, a 5-year-old could be cared for by a 10-year-old and a 15-year-old and aunts and uncles and cousins, the pair bond could break up and each could go and have a new baby with somebody else and create more genetic variety in their young. Leaving the human mind with the tremendous desire to fall in love and pair up, a tendency to divorce and remarry, the pattern that we see around the world today. But I call it a dual reproductive strategy, a tremendous drive to pair up and probably also clandestine adultery. I'm not going to talk about adultery because I don't have time, but we can certainly talk about it in the question and answer period. We now do know some of the brain chemistry of adultery. So, why do you fall in love with one person rather than another? 5 years ago, I had finished my 4th book called Why We Love, and Match.com, the internet dating site, came to me and asked me that very question. And I said, I don't know. You're asking me why we're all different, and I really study why we're all alike. So they said, well, think about it. They wanted me to start a new dating site for them, and I began to, and they wanted me to answer that question, why do you fall in love with one person rather than another? So I went home, and I began to think about it, and I am a basic scientist. I didn't want to just say what everybody else had said. So this is what I already knew. There's two parts of personality. Character, which is everything you grew up to believe and do and say and think, and temperament, all those characteristics that come out of your biology. For example, some people are more curious than others. Some are more aggressive than others. Some are more stubborn than others. Scientists now think that about 50% of who you are comes out of your biology, your temperament. And we know a great deal about those cultural factors that drive you to one person rather than another. For example, timing always plays a role. You fall in love when you're ready. We tend to fall in love with somebody from the same socioeconomic background, people of the same degree of intelligence and good looks and education. We fall for somebody with similar religious and social values, with similar goals, with the lifestyle that that we want. And certainly your childhood experiences play a role. But I began to think, could it be that your basic biology also pulls you to some people rather than others? You know, in America, and I think in Chile too, they say, well, we had chemistry, or we didn't have any chemistry. And I thought to myself, what does this mean? Does chemistry play a role? So I began to look at those traits that have a chemical origin. My plan was to create a questionnaire to see what your temperament is, and then watch on this dating site who was naturally drawn to whom. So first thing I did is I went back to the academic literature and looked at all of those studies that talked about the basic, the traits that come out of your biology. For example, genetic studies, single nucleotide polymorphisms, diseases of medication. For example, if you give L-DOPA, which is going to drive up dopamine, to a Parkinson's patient, they become much more creative. They'll also turn into a gambler or even a sex addict. But I once saw a woman who was drawing like a stick figure dog, and then before taking L-DOPA, and after taking L-DOPA, her dog actually looked something like a Rembrandt dog. I saw another woman turn into a really fine poet. So from that kind of thing, one begins to link the dopamine system with creativity. We know that LSD drives up serotonin in the brain and can give you a religious experience. Religiosity is in the serotonin system. So by collecting all this data, I began to see that there's four chemical systems in the brain, each one linked with a whole group of personality traits. So I'm going to go through these four chemical systems and the personality traits associated with each, and then tell you who is naturally chemically drawn to whom. I had to, because I was working for a dating service, create names for these individuals. We all express all of these chemical systems, of course, but if you're very expressive of the dopamine and norepinephrine system, I call these people explorers. Those expressive of the serotonin system I call builders. Those expressive of testosterone, the directors, and those expressive of oxytocin, the negotiators. Not great terms, actually. I'd change them now, but I'm a little stuck with them. So here are some of the traits associated with each chemical system. People who are very expressive of the dopamine system tend to be risk-taking, curious, creative. They've got a lot of interest. It's called sensation-seeking. They tend to be energetic, restless, excitable, optimistic. That's a very curious one. They're very optimistic. Independent, self-reliant, creative, very creative, often very generous, often very open-minded. There's a downside to any personality type, of course. They tend to be more reckless, unreflective. These are the ones that look out, not in. I happen to be one of them. I don't really care who I am. I was once at a meeting in America, talking to a pile of therapists, actually, and I heard myself say, you know, I don't really care who I am, at which one of them screamed from the back of the room, well, do you want to talk about that? Therapists. They tend to be more manic, energetic, opportunistic, unpredictable, and glib. Not all of them, of course. I did one study on this dating site, Chemistry. 8 million people have taken my questionnaire. 30,000 people take it every week. So I can do all kinds of studies on it. So one study was 178,000 people, and I wanted to know what words these people used. It's called the lexical hypothesis. It's been known since the 1930s. People use the kinds of words that express who they really are.
The top word used by the explorer
is adventure.
Energy, new, fun, traveling,
active. All words that you would expect of somebody expressive of the dopamine system. I then looked, I have everybody's zip code, so I looked at the major cities in the United States. And sure enough, explorers all go to the big cities where the action is. And I would imagine that there's a lot more of them in Santiago than other parts of Chile. I think Obama is has a great deal of the explorer in him. A lot of other things too.
One of the things that I really find interesting is
how optimistic he is. The day after he was elected in America, there's a humor magazine called The Onion. And the lead line on The Onion read, "Black man given worst job in the world." And indeed, he wanted it. People who are high dopamine are also very comfortable in their skin. They move with a relaxed nature that Obama does. He also has a very expressive face. It's not the high testosterone type. Builders, Plato called them guardians. By the way, these four types have been noticed since the ancient Greeks. Plato, Aristotle, on to Carl Jung, and around the world people have noticed these four very broad personality styles. What I've really done is link them with their biology. So this kind of person, they tend to be
conventional,
cautious, controlled, controlling, calm. That's why you take Prozac or Paxil to drive up serotonin, you become calm.
They're more structured. They like plans and routines.
The explorer doesn't like plans and routines.
Schedules, they're orderly. It's called sustained attention.
They're fact-oriented. They're concrete and literal. They're very good at things like accounting. They can be very patient. These are the people that can do the same job over and over. They can work in a pea factory and keep on moving those peas along. Whereas the explorer will just get their hands stuck in the machine.
They've got more close friends.
You take Prozac or Paxil and
your sociability goes up. They're good at networking. They know a lot of people. Religiosity is in the serotonin system. They like to follow rules. They tend to be more loyal.
These are basic characteristics that the genetic literature has linked with personality traits. The downside is they tend to be closed-minded, rigid, stubborn, moralistic, and controlling. The top word that these people use is
family. Morals, respect, loyal, trust. Trust and trustworthy, I used that one twice. Values.
It's a whole personality style. I did a lot of studies I needed to do to validate this questionnaire. I have 10 validity measures. Among them, I anticipated that these people would be more interested in conventional religion, not spirituality, but conventional religion. And indeed, they're considerably more religious. They're also a great deal more politically conservative. Your political views do have some genetic foundations. A good example of a person in the United States who I think is the builder type is Colin Powell. Colin Powell was the Secretary of State, or the head of the international relations for George Bush. And he's a very traditional guy. He was in the military. He was a military man, religious, really respects authority. Before Bush wanted to go into Iraq, and Colin, he did not want to go into Iraq. And then he went and made a speech at the United Nations. And before he made that speech, about 25% of Americans were willing to go into Iraq. After that speech, about 75% of Americans were willing to go into Iraq. He swung the American opinion and we went into Iraq. And I think he did it largely because he was following orders, because he is a builder. And I think that I'm beginning to really understand more about history and certain figures and the chemistry, the brain chemistry of certain figures at certain times in history that have played such a role in where we are today. Directors, the third type, are people expressive of the testosterone system, analytical, logical, skeptical. Certainly Einstein was that. Very good at math, engineering, computers, music. Music is very structural, experimental, inventive, rank-oriented, competitive, all associated with the testosterone system. Independent, decisive, bold, tough-minded. These people will tell you what they think, and very direct. I think the downside is they can be uncompromising. I'll skip that one. Demanding, aloof, impatient, and less empathetic. The top word that these people used on this dating site was intelligence. There's a lot of different kinds of intelligence, of course, but what Americans call intelligence is that deep, narrow focus, which is associated with testosterone. Also, debate. They actually find debating intimate. The other types don't find it intimate. They find it intimate. I just did a study of this a couple months ago. Geek, nerd, ambitious, driven, politics, challenge, and real. They're the least religious of the four broad types. Hillary Clinton, I think, is a perfect example. Extremely blunt, tough-minded. I'm glad that America did not send her into North Korea to get those two girls out. They sent her husband instead. Smart move by Obama. The last of the four types is the negotiator, people expressive of estrogen and oxytocin. They see the big picture. They tend to be intuitive, imaginative. And it's because the way the brain is built in the womb. As estrogen washes over the brain, as the brain is developing in the womb, it builds more connections between the two sides and between factories in the front and the back of the brain, giving this broad perspective, which I think leads to more imagination. They tend to be more introspective. These are the ones that care about who they are. And they think all the rest of us care, too. They're empathetic, altruistic, nurturing. They're very socially skilled. They've got verbal skills and people skills. They tend to seek harmony. They're agreeable. And they're emotionally expressive. They have what I call diplomatic intelligence. On the downside, they're scattered. They live in a world of it depends. Well, where do you want to go for dinner? Well, it depends. We could go here, we could go there. Well, make up your mind. I am making up my mind. Bottom line is they live in a world of a lot of alternatives. They ruminate, they overthink. One of the things that I say on this dating site is to the negotiators, stop thinking. You know, as Freud said once, he said, you know, sometimes a cigar is just a cigar. It's not, you know, these people impose meaning on everything. They tend to be indecisive because they can see so many ways of going. Hypersensitive, that's a problem in the business community. They're gullible, they're trusting, they're belief. They can placate, they're so agreeable. They can be they're very independent. It's a very interesting personality style. But they want to get along, they want harmony. So they don't want to hit you in the face, so they stab you in the back. They'll get you from the back when you're not looking. And they're effusive. The top word that they use on this dating site in a study of 40,000 people is passionate, heart, kind, sensitive, read. These are the big readers of the world because they're so verbal. Sweet, learning, random. Most of the other types don't like random. They like random. One of their top 10 words is random and empathetic. I think Bill Clinton's a good example.
As he said in his book, it's important to have a synthesizing mind. The whole world knows he can't stop talking. Real people skills. At his daughter's wedding a few weeks ago, he cried. His wife didn't cry. He cried. And he's famous in America for saying, "I feel your pain," which he probably does. I think Charles Darwin was, we're all a combination of all of these, of course. I think he was very much skewed to being the negotiator and the explorer. There's, I can't think of a single human being on this planet who's ever lived who has put more of the parts of life together than he has. He has taken from everything in every way in this very broad view of a man's place in nature and all of nature itself. That is the negotiator's mind, very much also the explorer type. So we're all a combination of all of them, of course. And when you take my questionnaire on the dating site or in my book, Why Him, Why Her, you get a pie chart. And this person is very high on the explorer and very low on the testosterone, high in dopamine, high on estrogen, low on serotonin, and even lower on testosterone. So I have 8 million of these, and so I decided to watch who's naturally drawn to whom. And this is what I found. Oh, first this. You know, I have all these zip codes, and so I decided to see where all these people live. And sure enough, look where the builders, traditional people, traditional religious people live in the American South and the Midwest. All the high testosterone live around Washington, D.C., where they're trying to run the world. Or they're out in Las Vegas. Gambling, that's nice, spatial. Or they're in Alaska shooting the animals, that's spatial. Explorers are all in California. Everything that's loose in America rolls into California. And all of the high estrogen types, the liberals, the big readers, are in the Northeast and the Northwest. And in fact, I've got this data for a lot of countries around the world. So I then took a look at 28,000 people to see who was naturally drawn to whom. And this is what I found. If you're a female explorer, you tend to go for male explorers. If you're a male explorer, you tend to go to female explorers. People who are daring, curious, creative, want somebody like themselves. Female builders, high serotonin, traditional types, want somebody who's traditional like themselves. Male builders want a female builder, somebody who's traditional like themselves. In those two cases, likes are attracted to likes. Similarity attracts. Female directors, Hillary Clinton, what does she go for? A male negotiator, Bill. Male director goes for a female negotiator. That's the classic. That's what you think of as the strong, aggressive, nonverbal man with this sweet, kind, verbal, charming, socially sophisticated woman. Female negotiator goes for the male director.
Opposite.
And male negotiator
goes for the female director. In those two cases, opposites attract. So here's what I think is going on. I'm going to trace the first 3 minutes of meeting somebody. You walk into a room and you look at them. Within less than a tenth of a second, you decide whether they're in or whether they're out. Too tall, too short, too old, too young, too fat, too thin, too pink, too green, they're out. So they stay in. You walk up to them. You start talking to them. They open their mouth. You hear their accent right off the bat. They're in or they're out. And then you start talking to them. And in the first 3 minutes, they'll say to you, that they're going to vote for Sarah Palin. They're out. For me.
You also begin to discover whether they can give you what you need, the lifestyle you want. So all of this plays a role, but all along the way, what I'm trying to add to this discussion of mate choice is all of those biological traits that pull you naturally to one person rather than another. So this is our third experiment. Can love last? All the textbooks say that romantic love cannot last. So we decided we would look and find out. And our team was led by Bianca Acevedo, a young woman, Lucy in the middle, our neuroscientist. And we put 17 people who were in their 50s, who reported that they were still in love with their partner, not just loving, but in love with their partner, into the brain scanner. And we found activity in the same ventral tegmental area, in the same brain region that becomes active when you've just fallen madly in love. We also found activity in a brain region associated with deep feelings of attachment. So as it turns out, in people who are in love long term, we
found activity in brain regions associated with romantic love, two areas associated with attachment. What was different was
that when you've just fallen in love, we find activity in a brain region associated with anxiety. When you've just fallen in love, you're anxious. You know, will he call? Am I too dumb? And that was no longer active. And what we saw instead was new activity
in brain regions associated with calm.
So if you're in love long term, you want them to come home for dinner. You're not talking about divorce. You want to share your day. You still want to have sex with them. And at times, at least, you are still in love with them. The message, of course, is that you got to pick the right person. So if I were with a group of therapists, I would then go into how these different types of matches, I mean, what happens in a relationship between a builder and a director, between a negotiator and an explorer? There's no really bad match. They're just going to have different ups and different downs. But I'm going to skip that and tell you, I just made this slide today. I'm so excited about this. I'm now working with a geneticist from Princeton. And what we're going to do is we're going to give people my questionnaire and have them spit into a tube, collect the DNA,
and we're going to look at these 63
alleles
and find out the whole array of genes associated with these very broad personality styles.
So I will end with this. And I suppose this is my message. And it's a bit of a metaphor. And it comes from a gender difference in intimacy. Women tend to get intimacy from face-to-face talking. We swivel until we're face-to-face. We do what's called the anchoring gaze, and we talk. That's intimacy to women. And I think it comes from millions of years of holding that baby in front of your face, cajoling it, reprimanding it, educating it with words. This is intimacy to women. Men tend to get intimacy from side-by-side doing. As he looks up, he'll look away. I think that comes from millions of years of sitting behind a bush on the grasslands of Africa trying to hit that buffalo in the head with a rock. You can't be talking like this if you're going to do your job. The problem, of course, comes from this. Thanks very much.
Gracias, Helen, por esa interesante presentación. Para los que sigan interesados en tener más conversación con ella, ahora vamos a abrir un poco el piso para preguntas, pero también mañana tenemos a las 11:30, encontramos ahí un horario para poder acomodar esto, una conversación de Helen Fisher con el doctor Beltrán Mena, así que están también cordialmente invitados a esa reunión. Y podemos, en ese caso, entrar más en profundidad en algunos de los temas que ha escrito y trabajado la profesora Fisher. Así que sin más, abro el piso para preguntas. Son todas, por supuesto, bienvenidas, pero les voy a pedir que sean lo más breve posible para que podamos tener una conversación más prolongada. Aquí hay una primera pregunta. Ahí. No, there is no question.
Sí. Volumen.
Yes, I can hear fine. Thank you.
Allá atrás. Vamos a tratar de ir por orden.
So, love is not unconditional.
You're saying it in English. Say that again.
So, love is not unconditional.
It's not.
There's not such a thing as unconditional love.
Oh, there. I think
there. Share your DNA. You want to.
I guess you've got to think of what you mean by unconditional. I do think that we have reproductive motives. We have social motives. We have economic motives. We have psychological motives. You know, love is expensive, and we generally don't do it for no reason at all.
Perdón, ¿aló? Una pregunta. Decías que el amor es una necesidad y una necesidad reproductiva que evolucionó por una necesidad evolutiva. ¿Se podría decir, o creo que hoy por hoy hay una tendencia en las parejas a tener menos hijos o a no tener hijos? ¿Se podría decir que hay una involución en ese sentido o cuál es la función del amor ahora que ya no hay una necesidad de tener hijos?
What's really happening, you know, in hunting and gathering societies, a man and a woman often had about 5 children, and only 1 or 2 lived to adulthood. So what we're going back to now is the kind of reproductive pattern that we had 1 million years ago. What's unusual is all these people who are choosing to have no children, and that really is unusual. Children are becoming so expensive, and more women are working way past their reproductive years and not having the opportunity to have children. So there is no question about it that is a new event in human evolution. We have, of course, an overpopulation in the world, and it may well be a rectifying response to that. I do think that we are at a time of tremendous transition right now in the world. For the last women's roles, there's 2 great social trends going on right now. One is women moving into the job market in cultures around the world, and the second is the aging world population. And both of them are, those 2 trends are making dramatic differences in the world of love. But what's interesting, to respond directly to you, is that even when we don't want children, we still want love. We still fall in love. We still form deep attachments and sustain them for life. This brain system will be with us as long as the human animal exists.
Hola, buenas tardes.
Yo tengo una pregunta sobre un tema que concita mucha discusión. ¿Existe el amor a primera vista? ¿Es amor? ¿Son las mismas reacciones que el amor romántico? ¿Hablamos de eso? ¿Es amor? Uh-huh. ¿Es como, o es simplemente atracción sexual? ¿Qué es lo que pasa ahí? ¿Es la misma reacción química?
I think love at first sight is actually pretty easy to explain. When you take a look at other animals, for example, a fox, when a male fox sees a female fox, he will instantly, you know, if she's the right shape and color and healthy and nice fluffy tail and nice whiskers and fits within his concept of a good breeding partner, he will instantly, almost instantly, become attracted to her and stay with her, not just for sex, but he'll stay with her and raise babies with her. And I think what's going on in the brain is this brain system for attraction is becoming activated instantly. And in fact, in when you take a look at world poetry, around the world people write about love at first sight. And in songs and in myths and in legends, people talk about love at first sight. And in one study recently of 100 people, 10 out of those 100 had fallen in love at first sight. It's never happened to me, but you can walk into a room and instantly think, oh, if that person talked to me, I could really like him. And I don't think it's just the sex drive. I think it is this attraction system in the brain. So I think that love at first sight comes out of nature, and it's a very natural human response.
Yes, I have a question, because if you say that everything is so like chemical or almost predictive, do you think that we can ever develop like a medicine or like some chemical to like stimulate the sensation of love, or to like avoid the pain that gets rejected?
Yeah. As a matter of fact, in America, they're now talking about a vaccine to keep you from falling in love when you're happily married. And there are scientists, very well-known scientists, who do think that we will be able to develop pills. I think they're wrong. I think they're wrong because romantic love is not just chemical. We have this huge cerebral cortex with which we make decisions. And as you grow up, you build an unconscious list of what you're looking for in a partner. And if somebody doesn't fit within that unconscious list, you're not likely to fall in love with them, no matter what chemicals they give you. I don't think any amount of chemistry could make Helen Fisher fall in love with Hitler. It's not going to happen, because we have this big cerebral cortex. As a matter of fact, I've often felt that the more we understand about biology, the more we are going to appreciate the role of culture and environment and cortical decisions in sculpting that biology. And I do not think that, you can take cocaine right now and drive up dopamine, and you may fall in, or street speed, amphetamines, and you may fall in love for the evening, but you wake up in the morning and you say, what have I done? You know, so I do not think, a lot of people fall in love when they take something like ecstasy or LSD. These drugs drive up the serotonin system and dopamine and norepinephrine, and they've often called them the love drugs. But they wear off, and you get back to your normal personality, and you're not drawn to certain people. So I personally do not think that we're ever going to develop a pill that'll make you fall in love with somebody long term.
Buenas noches, doctora. Una pregunta. Por lo que entendí, las personalidades que son directoras... Perdón. For what I understood, director personalities and negotiator personalities attract each other, and the other ones attract in between them. That's for a hormonal reason or for... that's...
It's not hormonal reasons. It has to do with the traits that go along with those hormones. I mean, the people who are expressive of the dopamine system tend to be risk-taking, novelty-seeking, curious, creative, generous, flexible, and they seem to be attracted to people like themselves. So, you know, if you're the explorer type and you come home from work and you suddenly, you know, you say to your partner, let's go nude swimming at midnight in the lake, you want them to say yes. I mean, this is the data that I found, that the explorer type, those who are expressive of the traits associated with the dopamine system, tend to be drawn to people like themselves. Traditional goes for traditional. Novelty-seeking goes for novelty-seeking. And then the testosterone and the estrogen seem to be drawn to their opposites. And I have a lot of Darwinian theories for why these three basic chemical patterns evolved. I think that a person who's very high testosterone who needs the compassion, the verbal skills, the people skills of the high estrogen type. And I think the high estrogen type needs the high testosterone decisiveness, tough-mindedness, analytical skills. I think they evolved to pool very different resources to raise their young. I think that two high serotonin types, traditional types, are they're building on very strong child-rearing traits, being cautious, conventional, social, networking, the kinds of things that would really be useful raising babies. The question for me was, why would two explorers go for each other? I mean, what, are they going to carry the baby up on Aconcagua? Or, you know, this doesn't make sense. And then I began to think, maybe, first of all, when two explorers find each other, they have a thrilling life. I mean, it can be thrilling. They're also reckless, and of course, they're probably more prone to addiction, and perhaps even to philandering, I don't know. But they may have a thrilling life. But this type may go from one person to another and create more genetic variety in their young, which can also be a Darwinian adaptation. So, and you know, there's all kinds of variations. For example, the person who is very much of the explorer type, and they go out with a lot of people for many years, and then they suddenly want to settle down. So what do? But they pick a builder who offers home and family and community, and they do settle down. And if they continue to respect each other, they have very different skills for raising babies. But very often, I suspect, after a while, the explorer will get bored, and the builder will say, why can't you ever stay home and watch TV? Why do you always have to go climb mountains? So there's going to be different kinds of tensions in all of these different combinations. And the more you understand those tensions, the more you can get around them. I feel that this data can be very useful for all kinds of things. For example, after I wrote my book, Why Him, Why Her, I sent an early draft to my editor, and he called me up, and I was waiting for what he would say to me. And there was a long pause, and then he said, I finally understand my son. And the son was very traditional, conventional, and he was very much of the explorer. And I now work with a lot of people in the business community because they want to sell to certain kinds of people. They want to reach certain kinds of clients. They should probably make certain kinds of teams in the workforce, build certain kinds of executive boards of directors. And once you begin to know the chemistry of various people, you can put together the kind of team that you might need that would be most effective.
One question regarding childbearing. You've seen couples that last a long time in your studies. Do you see a correlation with their childbearing occasions? So would that point to a longer attachment between partners?
Could you say that again? I'm not quite sure what the question is.
So when you started talking about the evolution of couples, you said that you would see divorce happening around every 4 years. did you see any correlation in the long-term couples with their child bearing?
Ah, yes, right. And the I studied three things, yeah. Duration of marriage, how many children per marriage, and age at divorce. And as it turns out, the longer you remain married, the more children you have, the more likely you are to remain together. There's a direct correlation between those three, which makes sense. You know, if you're in a long marriage, you're more likely to have children. And if you like the person well enough to have more children, you're likely to stay together. So there seems to be sort of two ways to reproduce yourself. Either you stick with one person and have a lot of children, or you go from one person to another and have children with each. And they're both actually adaptive strategies. A serial pair bonding, a series of pair bond relationships with different people, you're going to create more genetic variety in your young, but it'll be a less stable child-rearing process. Whereas if you stick with one person and have a very stable relationship, you may have even more children. All of this has to be looked at. But there's more than one way to send your DNA into tomorrow, and it's as if mankind has thought of everything.
One question in that sense, does the distance between the birth of one child and the next maybe form a signal into the brain that would coincide with a reattachment to the same person?
It's a wonderful question, and I don't know the answer, and nobody's ever asked.
And is somebody selling an MRI system to check on your couple if she's attached or he's attached?
Yeah. When I am out someplace in the public and somebody comes up to me and says that they were divorced, one of my first questions is, do you have children? Oh, yes, we had two children. My next question will be, how old was your youngest child when you divorced? And they will often say 5, 6, 4. And it's as if the real purpose of the ancient reproductive bond is no longer necessary. And so restlessness begins to occur in the relationship and people divorce. And then remarry. The triumph of hope over experience.
Good evening, Helen. My question, if sort of a percentage is chemistry, you know, the builder, explorer, et cetera type, and the other type is, you know, temperament, where we sort of grew up with believing, et cetera, why do we choose wrongly? I mean, the system seems to be perfect, so why do we choose wrong?
It's interesting, you know, very often somebody will say, I made such a bad choice, I married him for 15 years, and then the first thing I'll ask them is, did you have any children? And they'll say, oh yeah, I had two children, but you know, well, from a Darwinian perspective, that wasn't a bad choice. You passed your DNA on to tomorrow, and in terms of survival, you have won. And I think that, you know, I mean, life isn't perfect. We were built to reproduce. The brain was built to reproduce. It wasn't necessarily built to be happy. We go through all kinds of learning processes to make better choices. And, you know, this serial pattern of marriage, divorce, remarriage, you learn a lot. You build new networks. You mature. You have babies with them, and so it's part of the life process. It's the best I can do. I don't know the answer.
Dr. Fisher, welcome to Chile.
Thank you.
First, my question is about why does unrequited love exist? Why somehow a person who loves and will want love a girl with all his mind, with all his strength, with all his heart. Interestingly, we didn't talk about heart. Why this? How come a person who loves each other, the other person does not return the love. That's very interesting. And second of all, would according to all your research, would you suggest the use of a medicine drug to treat that kind of person? There may be a lot of crime brought about here in Chile. There are cases of so-called passional crimes of religion. So I believe not only in terms of romantic issues, but in terms of public security.
Crimes of passion are very common around the world. In fact, among the hunting and gathering group, the Kung Bushmen of the Southern Kalahari Desert have just as high a murder rate as in the city of Houston, Texas. Crimes of passion are everywhere. And I've often thought that nature overdid it, but anyway, I think that unrequited love comes from the fact that we have what I call a love map. In your early childhood, you begin to develop an unconscious list of what you're looking for in a partner. And when you see somebody who fits within that unconscious list of characteristics, and the timing is right, and you're ready to fall in love, you can just fall in love with that person. But that person, you might not fit within that person's love map, so they don't care. And as a result, you've got to get over it and go on. I think that, I wondered why it is that we have such a strong reaction of rejection. It doesn't seem adaptive. Why can't we just, when we've been rejected or somebody doesn't like us, why can't we just walk away? It seems as if we spend too much metabolic energy on people who don't love us. Why is that? And I had to try to answer that in one of my books, Why We Love. And my hypothesis is that when you're rejected in love or you have unrequited love, you often fall into genuine depression. And that genuine depression is an honest signal to everybody around you that you need help. And so you're going to acquire new networks, new social opportunities as you're signaling your problem. The other thing is psychiatrists know that mild depression makes you look at the world more honestly. You know, we live in a world of sort of rose-colored glasses. Do you have that term here? But when you've been rejected, you actually look more honestly at where you are, what you've got, what you need to do. And I think that depression and rejection helps you sober up and think of what you're going to do next, how you're going to do it, and pick the right person.
Hello. So the research focuses mainly on the perspective towards life between couples, but what happens in the situation where somebody claims to be in love with more than one person, polygamy maybe, how does the brain react towards?
When you are beginning to go out and about, and let's say you start going out with three different men, and you find one charming and you like him, and then you find the other charming and you like him, and the third. But time goes by and things happen, and you gradually or rapidly move your focus to just one of those three. And when people come up to me and tell me that they are in love, not loving, but in love with more than one person at a time, I don't think they love either. Romantic love is focused on one person. It's a basic characteristic of romantic love. You see it in cultures around the world. And when you're really, that high dopamine is expressing itself, you focus yourself to one person. Now, you might be sexually attracted to a lot of people. You may be deeply attached to a lot of people. You may feel some sparkle from some people, but when you're intensely in love, it's with one person.
Gracias. Hi, good evening. Well, welcome to Chile, and thank you for coming here.
Thank you.
I hope it's not the last time you come. Well, I have two questions. My first question is about inheritance. Can these traits or types of personality be inherited?
Can they be what?
Inherit, you know.
Inherited. Inherited. Inherited.
Sorry. Mm-hmm. My second question is, what happens with the cases that defy your theory? What happens with when people, you know, an explorer falls in love with an, I don't know, a builder? Why does it go against your theory? I mean, your facts are solid, but why does that happen?
Starting with the first one, I am talking about inherited traits. I'm talking about very particular genes in the dopamine system. These are some of the genes that we're going to look at, and they are inherited. But when egg meets sperm, there's an awful lot of different combinations. You can have over 8 million combinations. So two explorers aren't necessarily going to have an explorer baby. And there's an awful lot of alleles involved here. So I am talking only about inherited traits. So that's the answer to number one. Your environment can sculpt those traits. You know, how much can you really change personality? I mean, can you make an uncurious person curious? Well, you can make them a little more curious. Can you make a really person who's really bad at math better? Somewhat. They're never going to be Einstein. Can you make a totally disagreeable person charmingly harmonious? To some extent. Environment always sculpts biology. And with the whole new study of epigenetics, we now are beginning to know that the environment can actually turn genes on and off. So the environment and genetics have a real play with each other. But personality tends to be pretty stable. There's a lot of studies of personality over the life course, and it's least stable when you're young, when you're a teenager, and most stable in middle age. We can also act out of character. You know, you can be put into a business situation where you're required to be very tough-minded, and the negotiator can do it. It's just tiring. You can marry somebody who is and act for 15 years out of character. It's just tiring. So anyway, personality is relatively stable. There's a lot of studies of that. And certainly, I'm talking about inherited traits. You asked why it is that an explorer would marry a builder when, in fact, the natural pattern is an explorer marrying another explorer. Timing, proximity. This person has a lot of money.